Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome. My name is Bill Koglaser, the Science Technology Advisor to the Secretary, and it's my pleasure to introduce this is the third or the fourth in our Jefferson Science Fellows lectures. For those of you that aren't familiar with the Jefferson Science Fellowship Program, it's a terrific program in its eighth year. It was actually started by one of my predecessors in this position. It brings tenured faculty from U.S. universities, faculty in science and technology, to come and spend a year working at the State Department or in USAID, and then after their year here, also to be available for 5 years after that to continue consulting and helping with activities here in either USAID or the State Department. Peter Davies is our speaker today. He's a distinguished plant physiologist. He's a professor at Cornell University, where he's been for 42 years, teaching in the Department of Plant Biology and Horticulture. He holds both a bachelor and a PhD from the University of Reading in the UK, and before going to Cornell, he was also at Yale University. His expertise in the field of plant development, especially plant hormones and crop biotechnology. He's published over 100 papers and several books, and he's also the editor for the plant for plant physiology for the McGraw-Hill Encyclopedia of Science and Technology. So you can see he's truly a world-class expert in his field. At the Department of State, he's been a science advisor in the area of biotechnology, working in the Economics Bureau here at State. So it's a great pleasure to have him here today, and he's going to be speaking about crop biotechnology, science, and sustainability. Peter.
So thank you very much, Bill, for that kind introduction. And I'd like to thank all the personnel in your office for looking after the Jefferson Fellows while we're here. I'd also like to thank my host office, particularly Ed Kasker and Jack Bobo. And I won't name everybody else in the office, but thanks very much for being a great team and a very friendly group during my time here. Okay, today I would like to take this topic of crop biotechnology and give you some of the science as to how biotech crops, as we call them, are created, look at some of their characteristics and some of their advantages, and at the end, hopefully there's time to take any questions that you might have. So to start with, people tend to think that these sort of crops are relatively new, but one has to note that humans have been developing and modifying crops for hundreds of years by crossing both within a species and between species. And during this time, such selective breeding has led to crops with higher yields than their wild progenitors. As an example of this, we can look at modern corn on the right versus its progenitor, namely a wild grass called teosinte, which can be found in Mexico. Corn does not grow in the wild. It cannot be found in the wild. It was developed from this wild grass to what we have today solely by human activity. So what I'd like to start off doing is comparing traditional plant breeding with the modern biotech plant development. So first of all, what we need to know, as has been pointed out to us in previous Jefferson lectures, characteristics of an organism are determined by the genes, and the genes are composed of a sequence of bases of DNA in DNA arranged in the chromosomes. And what happens in traditional breeding is that you have a commercial variety in each of these little balls represents a gene, and you have one characteristic you would like to get in from a donor, and there's the yellow ball there in the wild plant. You cross these two, and you have a mixture in the new variety. But you have brought in the desired gene with a whole lot of undesirable characteristics. And this means there's a lot of work, often many, many years, to get rid of these undesirable characteristics surrounding the desired gene. What genetic engineering does is exactly what plant breeders have been doing for thousands of years, but doing it much more precisely. So the idea of genetic engineering is that you have a commercial variety or a variety you like, and you have one extra gene you would like to put in. And what biotechnology can do is insert that gene very precisely without all the undesired characteristics. And the other thing we need to note is that DNA represents a set of instructions, rather like a cookbook, and it is identical for all organisms. So that it doesn't matter where this gene comes from, it will do the same thing in any organism, provided that it has an on switch to start it off. So this is when a normal class, I turn to the class and I ask them to get out their clickers or personal response system, rather like Who Wants to Be a Millionaire? Unfortunately, the State Department hasn't got that high tech, so we're going to have to do it by a show of hands, but we've got to get some class involvement here. So the question for you is, you know your character, at least I hope you do, your characteristics are regulated by DNA, and so are the characteristics of a banana. So how much of your DNA do you share with the banana? And we're going to do it by a show of hands, and we're going to see how good you are at making this judgment. How many think you do not share any DNA with your banana? Okay, 1%. Show of hands, please. 1. 10%. A few. 50%. A fair number. 90%. Oh, well, most of you would be a bit more yellow than you actually are. So it's actually you share 50% of your DNA with a banana. Sorry, not 90%, but you do, there's quite a bit of similarity, and so we can have a conclusion from that. All right, now, having got us all on the same page with regard to DNA, let's have a look at why this topic is important. And we start off by looking, this is the human population running from 1750 to 2050. This is, we're just about there now. And as you can see, we're at 7 billion. And a further increase in population is expected by 2050. And this is going to represent a considerable increase in global food demand, so that in the next 38 years, we need to produce enough extra food to feed 9 billion people. And this means that we need 70% more food by 2050 than we have at the present time. And so the answer to this is that we need to do targeted modification of the plants to get a higher yield and other characteristics. So I'm going to start off by giving you a list of these characteristics, rather like I trust a good sermon in church. I tell you what I'm going to tell you, then I'm going to tell you, then I'm going to tell you what I just told you. So we're going to start off with what I'm going to cover, the benefits of crop biotechnology are that we can obtain increased yields. The result of this is that we can use less land and leave more land for nature. With some crops, you can do less till. That means less turning of the ground and less soil erosion. And because of the fewer operations with tractors, you can use less fuel, and as a result, less CO2 is emitted and less contribution to global warming. Some biotech crops have the incorporation of insect resistance, and this can decrease the use of toxic pesticides. Some more recent developed biotech crops make use of disease resistance, so you can maintain the yields without spraying, and with some diseases it's impossible to spray. So this is very important, particularly in developing countries. Some new top crops have tolerance to drought. I'm going to cover all these in a bit more detail as we go. And some newly developed crops, or they're not out yet, but are going to be offering improved health and nutrition. So before we have a look at each of these individually, I'd like to tell you how these crops are developed. Oh, before that, I see we're going to have a look at how these actually have been adopted. And here is some figures for the global area of biotech crops from 1996, when the first crops came in, through 2011. The green line is the total area in hectares. These are millions of hectares. A hectare is about 2 acres. So if you want acres, double this number. The blue line is industrial countries, and the red line is developing countries. Now, what is interesting here is that while we still have an increase in the adoption in developed countries, which adoption in developing countries is the area that is actually picking up. And on this map, the ones that use biotech crops are in green, and the countries that have not yet adopted this technology are in yellow. And if we look at individual crops, we can see that, again, this is global adoption rates percent. This is the millions of acres, millions of hectares. We can see that cotton is 82% biotech, soybean 75%, maize or corn 32%, and canola, which is an oil crop, 26%. So with some of these, a good proportion is already biotech, and in the United States, it is even higher, particularly for maize. So now we will turn to how these are made. And my own university has been central to some of these developments. And one important thing was discovered or worked on it's over 50 years ago now. And this was a plant physiologist named F.C. Stewart working at Cornell, actually another Englishman working at Cornell. And he was able to grow a whole carrot plant, not from a seed, but from a single cell of a mature carrot. So the idea was as follows. He took a carrot, he took some cells of that, put them in a nutrient solution, manipulated the hormonal content, and the little cells started growing as if they were embryos. He then took these embryos, put them on nutrient jelly, and from that he was able to get a carrot plant. And so we have now gone round a complete life cycle without actually having a sexual step. And this was the crucial point that enabled plant biotechnology to develop. You have to be able to develop a whole plant from a single cell. The other thing that has to be done in plant biotechnology is to move genes. And there are two main ways of doing this, and we call this plant transformation. The first actually uses a bacterium, and the bacterium is called Agrobacterium tumefaciens. And in nature, it causes a gall, what we call crown gall, which is a tumor disease of plants. And here you can see the crown gall. This is somebody's hand. You get some idea of the size on a rose stem. Well, we don't want galls on plants that we breed, but there's some interesting facts about this. You can find tumors on plants which are free of the bacterium. And initially this was a big puzzle. How could this occur? And it turned out that a small piece of bacterial DNA with the tumor-making instructions, and we call this little piece of DNA a plasmid, had been incorporated into the plant's DNA. Now, when molecular biologists discovered this, they started moving genes in, but they still got the tumors. So they were then able to work out which genes on the little circle of DNA, represented by this little circle here, this is not to scale, which genes caused the tumor properties, which again turned out to be hormone-making genes. They removed those, and they were then able to put in a gene of choice. So what we do is we start off by cutting, and this is done by enzymes. I don't have time to go into it. But they are able to cut the plasmid, find the DNA containing the gene for a desired trait, and cut that, put the two together, and now we have a splicing event. And so we now have the desired gene in the plasmid, and this is put back into the bacterium, and then the bacterium is put on the plant, and it does what it does in nature. It transfers some of these genes here from the plasmid into the plant cell. So you put the agrobacterium with the plant cell, it puts the genes in. So now we have, this is a plant cell, this represents a couple of chromosomes, and there we now have the piece of DNA that we wanted put into the plant by cell, by DNA, by the agrobacterium. And now we go through Steward's system of regenerating a plant, so we now have a plant with a new trait. So that's one method. The second method uses a technique called microprojectile bombardment, or more colloquially, the gene gun. So here we have some plants facing a gun. Not quite like that, but it's that idea. And here is the piece of apparatus. And what this does is actually fires gold particles into that are coated with DNA into plant cells. And the DNA miraculously, and that's what it was when it was first found, becomes incorporated into the plant DNA. This was also developed at Cornell, and it was developed by a strawberry breeder, and he thought of this idea, and what he initially did it with was a nail gun from a hardware store. You can go to Home Depot or Lowe's or wherever you want to go, and you can buy these nail guns, and they have little cartridges, and they normally fire a nail. Well, he modified it so it, instead of firing a nail, it shot initially tungsten particles. And the whole idea was sold to DuPont. Do we have any DuPont people here today? Yay. Was sold to DuPont, and we wished we hadn't, because DuPont made all the money off it. And but here, okay. Here we had it was modified to have air pressure. And here's a technician doing it. You put the particles here, the air pressure goes up, it blasts a membrane, and suddenly all these little gold particles get shot into some plant cells there, and you then go through the cell regeneration. And this is very useful because agrobacterium does not infect all plants. It's very good for tobacco, but tobacco is not considered a desirable plant these days. So if you want to do soybean or corn, this is a much better procedure. So this is the standard procedure for many plants that are not infected by Agrobacterium. So very quick, we're going to have a summary of this. Okay, here's Agrobacterium. So we can introduce genes using Agrobacterium, or we can fire the gold particles with DNA into the same plant cells. You then get the genes incorporated, and then you go through a cell replication system, plant them onto nutrient jelly, and you now have your plant modified with the new trait. So let's look at some of the traits that have been put into plants. I'm going to start off with insect resistance through what we call Bt toxin. The background for this is that corn or maize is subject to damage by various insects. There's a corn borer eating away, and obviously this decreases yields. But not only that, with the corn borer damaging the outer husk of the cob, fungus can get in. And here we see this black is a fungus. And this is dangerous because this the chemicals produced by this black fungus can be cancer causing. So that is a good reason to not want the damage and not want potentially dangerous chemicals in there. So what was done was to take the bacterium called Bacillus thuringiensis, which gives you the BT, and it produces a protein that is lethal to many insects. And it does this by inhibiting digestive enzymes in the insect's gut. Animals are immune to this. All other animals, it only affects the insects that are eating the actual plant. Now, the gene for this protein was taken from the bacterium and used to transform crops so that the tissues now contain this protein. What is interesting about this, by the way, is that this bacterium has been used for a long time to spray the whole bacterium or a bacterial slurry on the plants. And when this is done, the plants are regarded, or the produce thereof is regarded as organic. So you can get organic produce with BT bacteria already on it. However, this is a lot neater. Instead of having the whole bacterium there, you only have one protein put into the plant. And this offers season-long protection against insects that might eat the plant. Here we have regular corn. Here we have BT corn. And you can see no insect damage at all. And so we have higher yields. We have a damage-free crop, and in addition, there's no need to spray toxic insecticides to control insects. A second example, and the BT and this example were the first ones developed, is to improve weed control. And what we need to note is one of the biggest reducers of yield of crops are weeds that compete with the crop by shading it, taking the nutrients from the soil, etc. So it has been, for hundreds of years, one of the main objectives in agriculture has been to remove weeds, done initially with a hoe and then with a cultivation between the rows. But here's a better way to do it. And this is a herbicide called glyphosate. Now, we have many herbicides, and quite a few of them have selective properties. For example, the herbicide 2,4-D can be used in wheat. It kills broadleaf weeds. It doesn't kill the wheat. But glyphosate kills everything. You can go and get it at your local hardware store to spray on your path, or you know, your patio if you want to remove the weeds. So the crucial thing about this was to develop crops that could resist the glyphosate. But glyphosate is actually a much safer herbicide than any of the older ones on the market. It's safe because it targets a process that only exists in plants. It does not exist in animals. And in addition, glyphosate breaks down very rapidly in the soil, unlike many pesticide chemicals or herbicides that may persist for months or even years. You can spray, a farmer can, or a gardener can spray glyphosate on the soil and plant new plants into that soil the next day. One day is sufficient. So how does glyphosate work? Well, glyphosate works by inhibiting a biosynthetic process in plants, and here's a very simplified version of it. We have a precursor in basic metabolism, and it goes through many steps that I'm not detailing here, but it ends up producing a whole range of compounds that are very important to plants, amino acids that make proteins, phenolic compounds which are involved in defense, the natural defense of plants, and they're also flavor components, and it's also a component of lignin which is important in cell walls which holds plants up. But this process only exists in plants, and what glyphosate does is block one of the enzymes in this pathway. As I've said, animals do not have this process. They do not have this enzyme, so glyphosate has no effect whatsoever on animals. A great advantage over some of the older herbicides, which do have some toxic properties. Now, how were the plants made resistant? Well, what the biotech engineers did was they found a bacterium that was resistant to glyphosate, and they took a gene from this bacterium, and what it did is it has an alternative pathway. So the glyphosate still works, but there were other enzymes in the bacterium that managed to get round this block in the pathway. So when these genes were moved to plants, the plants were now resistant to glyphosate, and because this was a patented chemical, the named Roundup, the resulting crops were named Roundup Ready, and it's been transferred to many plants, including soybeans, corn, canola, cotton, sugar beet, and alfalfa. And these plants are unaffected by glyphosate, so you can have very, very clean crops, no competition for weeds, higher yields. The results of both these developments have now been combined, and there turned out to be many varieties of BT, and they target different insects. So now we have what are called stack traits. For example, there is one maize out there that has 8 added genes, 3 BT genes for aerial pests, 3 BT genes that target subsoil pests, and 2 genes resistant for resistors to different herbicides, enabling a rotation that prevents the buildup of resistance. And this actually is sort of a combined product from more than one company because different companies have different genes. Next advantage of these crops I would like to look at involves disease resistance. And one of the first ones to be commercialized for this was resistance to a disease of papaya in Hawaii. And this, again, was developed by my own university, by a plant pathologist at Cornell. And he came from Hawaii, And in Hawaii, papaya is an important crop, and it was hit by a disease called papaya ring spot virus. Here's papaya before the disease, and this is a Hawaiian plantation after the disease struck, and you can see how it is decimated. And so here's a little bit of detail. Here's a fruit with the ring spot. Here's the effect on the leaves. It is transmitted by a leaf hopper. And this is just a diagram of the virus, but the point I'd like to make here that a virus consists of a nucleic acid called RNA with a protein around it. And you have to have the RNA for the virus to be infectious. So what the scientists did in Dennis Gonsalves' lab is they took a gene for the coat protein only, which is non-infectious, and using the gene gun, they put it into papaya. And as a result, rather like when you get an inoculation against a disease, the papaya became resistant to the ring spot virus, and this is the resulting disease-resistant papaya. Now, in Hawaii, papaya is a luxury fruit that is exported. But if we go to a crop, a place like Thailand in Southeast Asia, it is a staple of the people. It's treated rather like a vegetable, and the virus struck there as well. So here is a papaya in Thailand struck with the disease, and you can see it's a pretty miserable looking plant. So the Thai scientists came to Cornell and they worked with Dr. Gonsalves to transform the local varieties of papaya, and here is the result. This is the biotech papaya in Thailand that is resistant to ring spot disease. And so this essentially rescued the local peasant farmers, where this is a very important part of their diet, rescued them from losing their one of the main items of their food supply. However, there are certain people around who don't like this. And once they heard that there were field trials, they arrived in this ridiculous garb, climbed over the fence there, and destroyed the field trials. And here is their activities in the capital in Thailand. And I leave you to judge the result of that. But they managed to persuade the Thai government that this was a wicked technology, despite the benefit to all the people. And they then persuaded the Thai government not only to cease supporting this, but to destroy all the trials. And there is the Thai government acting because the Greenpeace asked them to do so, despite the fact that this now means that the local farmers have lost their disease-resistant papaya. And so here's a reaction of one of the farmers. As you can see, no GMOs. However, if you walk around him and chat to him, that you will see that the high-tech farmers, and here he is with his computer, the high-tech farmers are very much in favor of this technology. And what one of my colleagues who has spent a long time in Thailand says is that there are clearly some biotech papaya being grown, because the farmers grabbed some before it was all destroyed, because that was the only way they were going to see their crop. And you can see the difference here. He's got virtually nothing there, and a very healthy growth there. So he's very much in favor of growing this. Some other products that have been developed, and here we are for the DuPont people. Here's your high oleic acid soybeans. And this is now, I believe, on the market, Linda. Is it? Yeah, is available. And so what the scientists have done here is change the oils that are in soybean, and they've changed it to make a high oleic acid. So it's rather more similar to olive oil. And they did this by preventing the expression of a gene that changes oleic acid to linoleic acid. Why would you want to do that? Well, it has a higher heat stability for frying in the food industry, and improves the flavor and the shelf life. So these are the sort of other things that can now be done. But of more advantage to peoples around the world are crops with enhanced nutrition characteristics. So one of these, example of one of these is called golden rice. And golden rice was developed in Switzerland, but is being, I was going to say commercialized. It is not commercialized, it has been developed for small farmers, first of all, in the Philippines. And why will we have this? Well, golden rice contains a vitamin A precursor, which prevents blindness in developing countries. If the people do not have enough vitamin A, they can develop blindness. And this doesn't have vitamin A in it, but it has the immediate precursor of vitamin A, namely carotenoid, which is the yellow color, and human bodies can convert this to vitamin A. And so here's what it has. It is high in carotene, and you can see the word carrot there, and that's the yellow color that you find in corn or egg yolk. And rice plants actually synthesize carotene themselves, but they do it in the vegetative parts, that's the leaves. They don't do it in the grain, so the grain is white. But by the addition of only two genes, the pathway was reconstituted and made to develop in the center of the grain, the part we call the endosperm, technically. And these are genes originally came from, well, I think you can see where they came from. They came from daffodils. But obviously there could be some problems with that. So instead of having daffodils, they redid it and they got the genes from corn, exactly the same things, but they come from an edible plant rather than in an inedible plant. So this is now up for approval in the Philippines, and we hope within a year and a half or so that it will be made available to the farmers. Another product that's going to be very important in the developing world is to cope with the decrease in water availability. We think that as a result of climate change, the climate change experts are predicting that there's going to be 27% less water in many of the agricultural areas of the world. And the areas that are going to be most affected by this are the areas that are in yellow or orange. You can see the much of the Corn Belt in the Midwest, the Grain Belt of Europe, and part of Sub-Saharan Africa, and also the Middle East. So this is going to be crucial to agriculture in the future. So another area where biotech plants are being developed are ones that have tolerance to drought. They need less water, they don't suffer from what we call drought stress, and they continue growing under conditions where normal crops would cease growing. So here we have, as you see, very dry soil, and the drought-tolerant corn is continuing to grow. This is two comparative rows. This is regular corn. As you can see, it's dead. The drought-tolerant corn is continuing to survive. So how is this done? Well, the first thing we need to note is that one of the effects of desiccation of plant cells, there are several effects of this, but one of the effects is that some of the molecules inside, the big molecules such as proteins or RNA, do not fold correctly. And folding, the way molecules fold, is crucial to their acting in the right way. And the first drought-tolerant crop to come up for approval possesses a protein that is made by a bacterium when this bacterium is exposed to cold. And it turns out that cold and drought have very similar effects in preventing the proper folding of these molecules. And this protein is called a chaperone, and it causes the correct folding of RNA. And, oops, wrong chaperone. So we have the correctly folded molecules in the cells, and they are thus able to withstand desiccation better, or semi-desiccation better than normal crops. Some other crops in the pipeline have enhanced nutritional characteristics for consumers. For example, high anthocyanin, that's a red pigment you get in blueberries, put into tomatoes. That's a purple tomato. And they've also put it into oranges more recently. This was just announced this month. Both of these come out of the John Innes Institute in England. And these have been tested in animal systems and also in human diet, and shown to decrease the incidence or potential incidence of heart disease. So these are health-giving crops. These are not yet commercially available, but these are the sort of things that are coming in the pipeline. So let's look at some of the advantages of these crops. First of all, we need to note that these crops increase yield. This is the insect-resistant corn, insect-resistant cotton, and these are various countries of the world. And you can see, we can see significant increases in yield produced by these biotech crops. Here is the changes in corn yield in Indiana over the years. If we go back prior to the 1930s, the yields were consistently low, relatively. In the 1930s, hybrid corn was developed, and these have been continually increased. So we have seen constant increases there, and we're probably getting near the limit of just hybrid corn, but now with various biotech corns, we can see the yield going up even higher. And the top test yields in 2010 were producing 1,200 bushels per acre, or 19 metric tons per hectare. And if you look at the scale here, 1,200 is probably out of the roof of the State Department or something like that. So using the latest biotech crops, we can still get continued increases in yield. This is in the US, but there's even more potential for developing countries. These crops need fewer herbicide and insecticide inputs. This is the decrease in herbicide use with the herbicide-resistant crops. The blue is the actual decrease in herbicide use. The red is the effect on the environment, and this is because the herbicides used are safer than the ones used previously. This is 2009. This is up to 2009. This is the decrease in insecticide use. So we are not only do we have increased yields, we have less chemicals in the environment. We get less impact on our natural resources and the environment by having more land available because of these higher yields. And here's the land that it is being calculated has been saved by these biotech crops. And this is in millions of hectares that would not be available for wildlife if these biotech crops had not been adopted. In addition, as I've already pointed out, there is less soil erosion. One of the arguments against these crops is, well, we don't know they're safe. However, they've been extensively examined by scientific authorities and food safety authorities in both the US and Europe and other countries of the world and declared to be totally safe. They've been consumed by Americans for 15 years with no ill effects. And there's not a single documented case of illness or allergy caused by these crops. And in addition, the environmental effects or the possibility of invading areas surrounding are in fact found to be absolutely no different than conventional crops of the same species. Other objections you will see, well, they lead to the rise of superweeds. Well, a superweed is not a superweed, it's just a weed that is resistant to that one particular herbicide. So this can be solved by alternating herbicides. Superbugs. Superbugs are not really super, they're just resistant to Bacillus thuringiensis protein. And both of these can be prevented by good farming practices, such as rotations of crops or rotations of herbicides. And farmers are recommended to interplant a small area of non-BT crops with their BT crops in order to prevent the buildup of resistance to BT. And this is helped by what we call stack traits, where there are multiple traits in one particular seed line. There are some problems, and one of the problems is opposition, but it's not based on science. There has been very slow approvals in some countries, and some countries approve them and others don't, and this has led to trade problems. Another problem is what we call the low-level presence of unapproved biotech crops in international commerce. By low-level presence, I mean 0.1% found in the bottom of a shipping container, leading to an entire blockage of that shipping container, or sometimes entire shipment. So, in summary, biotech crops represent innovation, a more precise method of crop improvement. They improve competitiveness of our farming industry or farming industries anywhere because you get higher yields with fewer inputs. And they represent sustainability because there is less impact on the environment, decreased use of pesticide chemicals, and with decreased tillage, less impact on global warming. And so just some little stories to finish off. When first I started as a graduate student, Rachel Carson's book had just come out. And she pointed out the damaging effects of excessive use of pesticides on the environment. And this came out in the book Silent Spring, and I was a pesticide student. So my specialty at that time was herbicides. And I was rather shocked when one of my professors absolutely gave a stinging criticism of this book, because I felt I was also an environmentalist. And that's the reason I support the use of these crops because they are good for mankind and they're good for the environment. And following that, Norman Borlaug led the development of the Green Revolution, which provided crops for the world. But with the current status of the population, this is not quite enough. We now have to do more. And so we now have to make sure that we have the development of crops that benefit humanity and benefit the environment and are going to provide enough food into the future. And as I said, the answer, as far as I'm concerned, is that we must use all the tools at our disposal to optimize the characteristics of our crop plants. And there I will finish. So thank you for your attention. So if there are any questions, there are two mics, one on each side. Yes, Norma.
Peter, I just have, that was a lovely seminar. I just have a quick question. I missed how the resistance to the papaya ring disease is produced. I heard you say something about putting the protein coat protein.
The gene for the coat protein.
So does that mean then that the papaya plant has an immune system?
Well, this again was just an idea. There was at that point no basis for this. And it was rather a surprise, but they tried it. As with many discoveries, they tried it and it worked. And it has now worked with several other plant diseases. Yes, it's not the same immune system as in animals. We don't have the same cells as animals. Plants do not have the same cells circulating in their blood. But if you have this protein in each cell, it produces this resistance. To my knowledge, they have not worked out the exact mechanism of this. Alan, do you know anything? I've never seen them.
I'll talk to Norma later.
Okay. All right. Yeah, thank you. Norma. You want to go, Bill, to the microphone then as they want to record this?
Thanks for that talk. I think you did an excellent job at overviewing some of the biological underpinnings and addressing some of the policy implications. My name is Ben Rosenthal. I am a biologist. There were a couple of things that I'll limit myself. You mentioned that an exciting potential in biology is that genes in one place can perform the same function somewhere else. Although with the process of transformation, we don't always know that the transformation will produce the same effect, you know, in a replicate experiment. You don't know, for example, where is the gene going to go, and is it going to modify some other function? So I thought maybe you could elaborate on that a little bit. And I would ask you also to think about what we know from the context of medicine and public health in terms of the evolution of resistance. So you said, well, we can switch to another pesticide if we're selecting for resistance. But our experience in public health is that the overuse of antibiotics, for example, typically results in the loss of their utility. These biological systems kind of have a memory of to what they have previously been exposed, and we kind of give up tools, particularly when resistance is plasmid mediated, it's just transferred. And if you could talk a little bit more about whether you think there is justification in some fears that overplanting of certain resistant crops may result in the permanent loss of some of the tools currently in our armamentarium?
Two very good questions. Yes, with regard to transforming the plant cells with these genes, there is no control as to where it goes. In addition, you've got to put it in with the on switch, which we call a promoter. So when you hear a talk like this, it sounds miraculous. We're going to the lab in the morning and we have our biotech crop in the afternoon. The success rate is extremely low. So it has to be done a huge number of times. Obviously, if the gene happens to insert in the middle of an essential gene, then the plant will not grow well or grow properly. So there is a low success rate of getting it in, getting it in the right place, and then checking to make sure that you do not have any major losses or adjustments. However, it has to be remembered that the vast majority of DNA in an organism does not represent DNA that is encoding for proteins. It may have a regulatory function. We used to call it junk DNA. We now think it is not junk, but there's a whole lot of DNA which, for example, in humans, there's a certain amount of DNA which appears to represent ancient viruses that have got into our DNA. So there's a lot of places you can put it with having no effect. But it takes, in general, these big tech companies, they reckon it takes 2 years to do anything. And what is interesting, it takes about 10 years to get it to market because of another 8 years of testing and regulatory action. And the figures I've seen, it takes these tech companies about $170 million to get a new trait to market, assuming it works and they know what they're going to try and do. The next question was with regard to resistance. As I pointed out, the resistance is to the particular herbicide or is to BT. And there are problems where farmers are not paying attention to this. They have this wonderful new crop, the higher yields, and they just do the same thing again, again, again. They're surprised when there's a problem. But there are guidelines out there that for BT, they should include 5 to 10% of non-BT corn, so the insects go and eat that. And the idea was to put it round the edge. Farmers weren't doing that, so what the seed sellers are now doing is mixing it in, so the farmers don't have a choice. With the multiple genes, what we call the stack traits, because there are now in the one I gave as an example, there are 6 genes for BT. Each BT is slightly different, and the resistance to one does not necessarily carry over to the other. So by having these multiples, they think there's less chance of doing it. And into this stack trait corn, they mix in 5% of non-modified seed. So yes, the potential is there. And hopefully farmers will take note of this, and some of them have been sort of at least vocally slapped on the wrist for not doing it, because we need to make sure that the farming practices do not promote the development of resistance. But as with antibiotics, I think antibiotics are a worse case, but as with antibiotics, we're probably going to have to continue to try and develop new methods of control.
Yeah. Peter, and you partially answered this one, but I wanted to ask about the U.S. regulatory system for what they're looking for when they're trying to approve a new GM crop. You indicated some of the issues in terms of time and cost, but what are the main issues that they're looking for in the regulatory process? And also, when you finish the question in a few minutes, I have a gift for you.
I love gifts. Okay, the regulatory process. It is rather a complicated process, which I've sort of only been learning since I've been here, that the USDA deals with the environmental potential, invasion or something like that. The EPA deals with toxicity of any pesticides, and the FDA deals with food. So the sort of thing that the FDA is going to be interested in is whether the protein in the crop produces an allergic reaction in any person that's eaten it. Obviously, there are very simple tests. Feed it and see if there's any visible effects. But that's at the very basic level. So there's got to be feeding studies, protein comparison studies, studies to make sure it doesn't become invasive in nature, studies to make sure that any pesticide that's put on it is not going to be harmful, that any pesticide gene in it is not going to be harmful. There's an interesting story about the BT, again, my own university. The paper came out claiming that it would kill the monarch butterflies. Well, monarch butterflies do not eat corn. What they've done is they've taken the corn pollen and put vast amounts of it on milkweed leaves and then said to the caterpillars, here, eat that. And the caterpillars weren't too happy. Which isn't surprising. But other scientists at my own university, we have these internal, in fact, the same department, then went out and looked in nature, and basically very little pollen gets on the milkweed that these would be eating. But in addition, it has to be noted that if you have BT there, you're not going to be spraying insecticide, and the insecticide would have a far greater effect than a few grains of pollen. So it turned out to be not important, but that was something that had to be thoroughly investigated from a pesticide environmental point of view. What I think I'm going to do is I think I'm going to have to go around and visit all these agencies and see exactly what they're spending their time doing. So I can't answer your question any further than that. Oh, yes.
Thank you for the wonderful talk. I did have a similar question to the gentleman before me regarding regulation. I was wondering if you could speak to issues of intellectual property and patents regarding transgenic genes and the debate surrounding that in the biotechnology field.
Sure, yes. There's two things one needs to remember here. Some of the NGOs complain about this industry being controlled by major corporations. First of all, one needs to note that the ones that produce the biotech seed are also major producers of non-biotech seed. So they are important seed producers in the industry. At $170 million per trait, it is very difficult for a small organization to carry a trait through to commercial production. And one of the reasons for this is the extremely heavy hand of the regulations and the testing that has been imposed as a result of the actions by various NGO groups. So in placing these extreme demands, they have made it very difficult for any university or small business to produce a biotech crop. And that is why we find that it is the major companies that are doing most of the production. Now, we come to patents. If you do not have patents a commercial company cannot afford to invest money in producing these products. And we accept patents in engineering, we accept patents in pharmaceuticals, and therefore it is reasonable that any commercial company receives a return for the extensive investment made. This is not onerous, because if it was onerous, you would not see the adoption of these crops. But as you saw, the adoption is going up and up and up. And the basic reason for this is that the profits that farmers can make exceeds the cost of the seed, and usually by a considerable amount, because farmers are all business persons. So I think it's a quite a reasonable thing. However, it needs to be pointed out that golden rice and drought-resistant maize is going to be released to subsistence or small farmers without cost. If indeed these farmers, for example, the drought-resistant maize, start producing it commercially, then it is reasonable that they pay a fair price for the seed. It also needs to be noted that hybrid corn is only produced by big seed companies. A farmer cannot save the seed, because if you do, the yield goes down because it's no longer hybrid. And so hybrid corn companies produce the hybrid corn and they sell it at a premium. But if you look at the corn growers in the United States, it's probably 99.99% grow hybrid corn, because the yields are double what you would get if you grew non-hybrid corn. So there's also precedent for this outside the biotech crops. I don't know, did that cover you? Questions, okay?
Yes, thank you.
Okay. I believe...
Could I ask a question?
Oh, one. Yes, sure.
I'll try to make it quick. I believe one of the earlier slides you showed was talking about the use of biotechnology crops around the world, and Europe was one of the areas that I don't think the rate had increased in your slide. And I'm wondering how you would address the issues that people like the Greenpeace people have that destroyed the field trials about the papayas. How would you go about getting the buy-in from the non-technological people, the ones that are on the ground, that are dealing with, that have issues with the genetically modified crops? There's the technology aspect of it, and there's also the social and political aspect of it. And how would you go about trying to get those people to buy into the advantages of the biotech crops?
This is one of the very difficult aspects of this. In general, I feel that people in countries that do not want this have been made afraid of the technology. And this is largely because they don't understand it. And there are various NGOs that are working hard to keep them afraid of it. And really, I don't understand the reason for this. My colleague does have a suggestion, but I will not publicize that suggestion further. But what is interesting is that, I don't know if we have any representatives from NGOs here, but one of the main ones is Greenpeace. Greenpeace has started off as saving the whales, which I thought was a good objective, and also protesting nuclear weapons tests. I thought that was a good objective. I was a member of Greenpeace. But since they have changed their focus to oppose these biotech crops, the original founder of Greenpeace resigned from the organization, and I also resigned some 15 years ago as a protest over this. The people in Europe in general don't need it because they have a high enough yield of their agriculture for the European population. So they can get away without it. The tragedy is that there are many, for example, African countries that look to Europe for leadership. And Africa does need to get severe increases in its yields to cope with its population, particularly in light of the changing climate. And they are influenced by the decisions in Europe. And this is very unfortunate. So that is the main effect of the European attitudes. But there are some countries I found the farmers very receptive when I was over there. I was over in Spain and Portugal. And they are just clamoring in Spain for drought-tolerant maize because the weather has been getting a lot drier in the Iberian Peninsula. In general, we find the farmers are for it, but it is the politicians who are against it. And when you speak to them, they say, oh, we know the science is correct, but we have to do it for political reasons. And that's what it is, I think. So, Bill.
Well, as we thank Peter, I've had to give a couple talks recently to people from the Defense Department. What I found after my talk, I was kind of surprised. The host came to shake my hand, and when they shook my hand, all of a sudden there was some piece of metal in it. Most of the officers in the Defense Department have these little medals they produce that distinguishes each one. Well, one of Peter's colleagues, the Jefferson Science Fellow, thought the Jefferson Science Fellows needed exactly the same sort of emblem. So I want to shake his hand and present him.
Okay.
With
thank you.
A giant piece of metal, which all of the other Jefferson fellows can come collect theirs. It is one giant emblem of Thomas Jefferson. And the Jefferson fellow who thought of this idea will remain nameless temporarily, but he'll expose himself when everyone else comes to get theirs. But thank you all for coming, and thank Peter again for a great talk.
Thank you very much, Bill.